Bonsai tonight. What did you first respond to when you heard Cornell and Stella speak?
I'm going to start where Stella was ending, actually, because...
Louder.
No, louder.
Okay.
Check.
My one works better. Oh, wait, I go a little closer. Here we go. This works. All right. Check. Mic check. We can do a people's mic here. I think we are living in a revolutionary bubble, actually. I think that, granted, with the electoral wins on the right, and there are some far right groups. So that is part of the conversation. But what has been happening over the last few years, in particular since 2011, millions and millions and millions of people are organizing from Occupy here in the US, and in Spain, and in Greece, and in Turkey, and in Brazil, in Bosnia, all over, and organizing in a way rejecting what's been bequeathed to us, rejecting a form of representation, rejecting the relationships that are capitalism. Maybe not saying we're anti-capitalist, but rejecting those relationships. And organizing in a different way. So organizing not to say, okay, we don't want this, now we're going to ask for something else. It's not about demands. I think what's so one of the many things that's so revolutionary about what's happening now is that people are organizing with goals without demands. So what that looks like is as people are organizing rather than say, and it's not being anti-reform, I'm for revolution. But I'm also against reform and against revolution. Because when we think about reform, we think about asking and putting ourselves in a different position of power rather than feeling our power, which is what I think the movements have been doing around the world now. And yes, absolutely revolution, we have to get rid of capitalism. But we have to think together about what that's going to look like. And when we talk about revolution too often, we think, you know, okay, we're going to get the newspaper, build the party, take the state in some kind of order. And the taking of the state is part of what's being rejected. Not that we don't have to get rid of the state, we do. But the idea of just replacing it with something else is what these tens and hundreds of millions of people around the world are saying no. In many languages, in Egypt they say kefaya, you know, which is enough. We say yabasta all over. We're going to keep dialoguing, so I'm just going to kind of put out there the first thing I'm responding to is I think this is a revolutionary epoch. I think there are tens and hundreds of millions of people acting similarly. And when I speak, I'm speaking as Marina, but someone who's been a participant in the movements and spent time with people in the movements around the world. So I think I can carry that with me, having spent time in Latin America. I feel like I'm speaking from some of that place as well. So just to kind of begin it and question what this moment is, how much potential and power we actually have.
I thought the title of tonight, because I play with words, can be interpreted very many different ways. Reform or revolution? Is that a question for us, or is that a question that we pose to the people that don't want any progressive change? If you don't give us reform, pacification, placation, which a lot of times it is, you will get revolution. Therefore, to create reform, they're more than happy to see some reform come through because what they're terrified the most of is revolution. They want reform. They're willing to tolerate some reform, but they want it in small increments because they're afraid of a challenge to the system. The other question is reform or revolution? The brother here, or the elder here, said reform revolution. That's what we need to do. We can't just reform the aspects that revolve around us. We need to reform the idea of revolution itself. If we decide that we all of a sudden become a revolutionary-minded individual, but we don't leave behind all of the privileges that we were born with or that we've assumed in life because of wealth or racial status in America, then what really do we have as camaraderie to be with the people that are suffering the most in the system? Also, one of the things that attracted me very much to this conversation is the idea that you can believe in God and be a revolutionary as well. You don't have to choose one or the other. And And I say this because I have a lot of relatives that are born again Christians, and if you argue with them about the Bible, you'll be there all day. And it's a great conversation because I know the history of Christianity as opposed to just the gospel. But I remind people, remember, it's in the writing, it's in the history of this country. You know, at the certain point, you'll find a person, would you believe them if they said, I know everything about America, but they've never lived here, right? They've read the Constitution. They understand sort of how it works. They said, oh, yeah, I know exactly how America works, but you never voted in America. You never went to college in America. You never were arrested in this country. You never had a job. You never paid taxes. That's the issue that I confront sometimes when I speak to people who come at me from religiously fundamental views. You know everything about the book. You read the Quran back to front and the Bible front to back. Yet you know so little about the history that created the situation for that power to arise. I think that if we apply this same mechanism and we take a look at the history of the United States, we can see that capitalism and democracy, as I said long ago, are not synonymous. And as a matter of fact, they've been on opposite sides of each other since the advent of the Republic. Just to close very quickly, people blame hip-hop and music and video games for violence in America, but I just want you to, again, read the history. This republic, since its founding, has known 20 years of peace. 20 years, ladies and gentlemen. 20 years, brothers and sisters. 20 years, mothers and fathers and grandfathers and grandmothers. 20 years, and they haven't been together, and they haven't been consistent. Don't tell me that music, that the poorest people who have no control over the system make, creates violence. This country was violent since they first genocided the indigenous people that lived here.
Relatively, we bounce back. We are bounce back people. And I say we, I'm not just talking about black folk, but I always begin on the chocolate side of town. And look, I am a black freedom fighter. And it spills over to my precious vanilla brothers and sisters, and brown, and yellow, and indigenous people. But I am a black freedom fighter. Why? Because my mama's black. My daddy's black. And they have been the ones who have been rendered invisible when we talked about change and transformation and movements. But we have a broad enough vision that we are just as concerned about the Palestinian babies, just concerned about the Ethiopian babies, the Jewish babies, the brown babies, as we are the black babies. But it still begins on the chocolate side of town. That awakening, yes. Revolutionary effort, aspirational. I'm with you at the level of aspiration. But those who are running things right now are vicious, cruel, mean-spirited, will crush you in a minute, and all you need to do is look at the condition of America's children, 22% poor, 40% of all children of color poor. That's not a sign of success for the left. That's not a sign of us in a revolutionary epoch in that sense. But the awakening is real, no doubt. And the art is always fundamental. It's no accident that last year was the first time in 50 years we didn't have a black artist who was number one on the pop chart of Billboard. Because all you got is bubblegum music. And right now, the number one song for the black artist is Happy, Happy, Happy. Cartoonist music. It got nothing to do with Coltrane. It got nothing to do with Curtis Mayfield. It got nothing to do with Nina Simone. It got nothing to do with Gil Scott Heron. And more technique is on the move.
Combined. people are fighting to get work, to get hours in the fast food industry. They get 6 hours, but they can't actually get health insurance. And if we fought for the 6-hour day and fought for it in the factories, fought for it in the service institutions, fought for it on the street, we would have a different kind of situation. I'm going to use this as only one example. The problem is that's not a little reform. People did, in fact, die to the fight for the 8-hour day. People died to organize unions when the unions were coming up from the bottom. So that if we actually had a serious attempt to organize Walmart, you would see how difficult that would be in terms of forcing violence. That would be another small reform. Only a million workers in Walmart don't have the way to live. $8.88 an hour. But it's not going to happen from within the official trade union movement. It's going to happen from the outside. Where from the outside? I want to say one more thing and I'm going to stop. We've had movements. You're absolutely right. And there's an argument that I make in my latest, this book on labor, which I just finished, that we should not take power over the unions. I don't believe in that. Because I don't think it's going to work. If we take power of the unions, we're going to have to break the law. That's a different kind of power. But our problem at this point is that we have to be realistic about what happened to the landless peasant movement in Brazil when a workers' party coming out of the official trade union movement broke the landless movement. We have to look at what's happening in Bolivia, where the Bolivian government, which everybody thought was hot shit, is now developing fossil fuels to be able to survive as a country, because you can't have a socialism in one country. I learned that from being a Marx Stalinist. You can't have, you don't even have a Latin American economic union. So we have to be very careful about our characterizations. I think we're at an interesting point. When Cornell says there's a lot of awareness, I think that awareness is there. But what can happen with the awareness? It can go in three directions. People have tremendous awareness and they go to the right because the right has a spiritual message. And it's not necessarily a religious message, it's a message of redemption. We don't even know the word redemption on the left. Although there were some leftists who did know many meanings of the right. The second place that people can go is that they can go into despair and they can retire from politics even though they have a tremendous amount of understanding. Hegel talked about that in 1807 in the Phenomenology of the Spirit. He called it the unhappy consciousness. You have the unhappy consciousness because you don't think you can win, you don't think you can do anything, and so on. The third possibility is that we develop a spirit not of reform but of revolutionary fervor. And people begin to say it is not acceptable for us to take $10.10 an hour and small reforms even if they're awful. Of course that's not a reform even, by the way. That we can have something that will change. And the only way we're going to get it is not by resistance alone, although I'm for resistance. Not by protest, although I'm for protest. But we have to have a conception of what is the good life. And your point is correct. In order for everybody to have a good life, some of us are going to have to give something up. And when we learn to give something up, to have a good life for all, we really meant that we want to have equality. Not $10.10 an hour, but equality. Then that's going to need a fundamental massive redistribution of wealth, even for the people like Cornell and me who make money. I'm serious. You make much more money than I do, but that's but you know what I mean? But these are things that we have to talk about. We're unwilling to talk about wealth and power. We're unwilling because we don't have the least idea what it means to have any kind of genuine power in a society which has deprived us of even our citizenship. You think the people of Katrina had citizenship? You think the people of Staten Island had citizenship? They didn't have democratic citizenship. They could have voted, it was the same old, but there was no citizenship. They had no power over their own lives. And that's what participatory democracy really means. It means you make decisions over your own lives. You do not depend on the state. You do not depend on powers from above. That's why in the 60s we had a movement.
Where we are now. A friend and a compañero for a while, who's a mentionist, writer, also talks about societies in movement when he's talking about what's been happening in Bolivia, Argentina, Brazil, and those, since the late 80s, really, since 1989, not coincidentally, but we're there right now. And societies in movement, not social movements in the traditional sense. So it is partly why, as people are organizing, it's not around the forms of organization that we've seen in the past, because they don't have the same claims on institutional power. People are not looking to the state or institutions of power for change to happen. So they're not reform-based movements. It's people looking to one another. So anyone who was part of any of the Occupy assemblies or went through a really long whatever discussion, but you're facing each other, you're looking at each other, and that's the place. That's where we're locating power. We, tens, hundreds of millions of people who've been organizing in the last 2.5 decades. So societies in movement, creating this revolutionary epoch, but revolutionary in the sense of everyday revolutions. That's something coming from people in Argentina. So thinking about how we're transforming our relationships, our lives, using forms of direct action, not just having nice assemblies, which is good, it's very affirming, it's very important to feel a subject, but then doing concrete things. And so, for example, looking in Latin America, the recuperated workplace movement, which started in Argentina, is now in Brazil, it's in Uruguay, it's in Europe. There was just a meeting in Marseille with 150 people. There are a number of recuperated workplaces in Europe. Recuperated meaning they use that language, meaning taking back what you see as theirs. So working people, rather than facing unemployment at an empty workplace, take it over, not asking, not demanding. Yeah. No, all over. Greece, I was in Thessaloniki with the workers in Biomed, and taking the workplace and saying, no, this is ours, we're going to run it, but we're going to run it differently, we're going to run it horizontally. And there are now 68, actually, just in the last year in Argentina. So it's a phenomenon that's increasing. This is not the alternative. This is not the revolution. But this is exercising our revolutionary muscles in what it's like to live a value system different than the capitalist value system. So that's what I mean when I'm saying this. Epoch, people are not saying, please give us our job. Well, also, I think I agree, because we're not going to get the jobs anyway, so why are we even going to ask? I think it's not necessarily ideological, it's just the reality. So we're going to take it. We're going to do it. The housing movement all around the U.S. I was recently in Chicago. It's incredibly powerful in Chicago. Spain, all over these movements where people are not saying, please give us houses or please don't evict us. You know, taking it apart from the 1930s in the U.S. saying, we're not going to allow the eviction to happen. So neighbors come together in these horizontal centers. So yes, the power is with each other, with neighbors. We're going to not allow a person to lose their home, a family to lose their home. And people are succeeding. They're retaking homes that are abandoned, talking to people in neighborhoods, retaking neighborhoods. That's the power. That's this different moment. That doesn't mean that later there's not a negotiation with a bank. Often there is. But that's a different order of a conversation. As far as where is power located and why we don't have demands, but we have goals.
I think that's a very powerful point, but it's something that is often overlooked when those of us who usually are targeting the nation state and targeting traditional forms of organizing. I saw it in Madison, Wisconsin, with the landlord movement taking over various houses and so forth and so on. But like our dear Sister Cecily who's on her way to jail, 3 months coming out of the Occupy, well, let's give her a hand. When you have this kind of society in motion, when the nation state targets you, you still need protection. You still need the Lawyers Guild. She needed to stand up for constitutional rights. She needed our voices, and she continued to get our voices. And that's what you talk about, is a different order, a different level. And at that point, we're in much deeper agreement than I thought at the beginning. I'm feeling the clip back. Because I see exactly what she said now, in a much clearer way. Because we do need protection. The nation state is going to keep track of you no matter what form of motion you come up with. And therefore, you're going to need protection. It's like when Angela got in trouble as a communist. Right? She needed protection by bourgeois progressive lawyers. And some revolutionary ones like William Constant and others. She needed that protection as a communist, even though she didn't believe in the legitimacy of the American political system. She still needed protection. That's going to be true even for those in the society of motion. But it's a different way of people relating to one another that causes them to question the dominant values that the nation state and corporation invigorates. Is that?
Of course, see, the example of Argentina and France and in Athens, the example of people taking over the workplaces that have been abandoned has one example in the United States, which is in Chicago. And that example was when the United Electrical Workers began to play around with the idea of taking over a window factory that had been abandoned by the company after they got a victory of severance pay. But I was in Flint. Several years back, I was a visiting person, scholar, something, whatever they call it, at the University of Michigan in Flint. Flint, Michigan is the birth of industrial unionism in the United States, right? And you saw a factory shut down, and nobody thought about how do we occupy the factory and how do we transform it into a place where people can work. And there were huge brown fields in the middle of the city of Flint, which are dangerous in terms of pollution, that are not being attended to. The problem is what we call the radical imagination. The Argentine workers have the radical imagination. The radical imagination says we are going to occupy the plant, and we're not simply going to occupy the plant to get recognition from the boss, as they did in Flint, Michigan in 1937. We're going to occupy the plant because we want to work, and we're going to take it over. So we need a whole system in the United States of co-ops. One of the things that bothers me about Occupy, I met with some of the organizers who said they weren't leaders, you know, the old crap, you know, we're not leaders, we're just, you know, plain old folk, and we're not just plain old folk. And I met with them, and I said, look it, what are you going to do when it's dead of winter, when the movement is cleared out by the city, not just New York, but, you know, 18 mayors, and Holder was basically coordinating that. What are you going to do? What's going to happen with Occupy? And what they gave us was horizontal networks will depend on horizontal networks, and we don't need an organization. And I said, with all due respect, you don't need an organization to get into the mainstream and vie for leadership of mainstream organization, but you need an organization so you can continue your work. And they said, and this is a quote, if we agree with you, family, six of them, we agree with you, but if we did that, we would split the movement. And I said, good. Sometimes you have to have splits in order to go forward. If all we have is unity, and that unity means we're going to be paralyzed, then we don't need that kind of unity. And our problem is not simply a question of tactics of organization, but our problem is really what it is that we think constitutes the exercise of power. Now, I'm not opposed to running election campaigns. I have one of the signers of Howie Hawkins for governor. The only real candidate. But that's not the key. That's one of the places. if we really do in fact think of ourselves as people who are not going to take leadership in the narrow, old-fashioned sense, but are going to be the catalyst for the movement that we're talking about, we can be powerful and we can be important in terms of the environmental movement. But as long as we're still talking about, oh, Obama's no good, so we have to have somebody better, oh, the da-da-da-da, if that's all we can think about, and de Blasio is going to disappoint some people and say, well, we need a better name. No, no, no. The state is the state is the state is the state. We haven't come to terms with the state. I would be for Syriza taking power in the East, because it would be a tremendous object lesson. I could be proven terribly wrong if they took power. But I don't think so. That's a position. That doesn't mean that I'm happy in that position. I'd like to be able to say, oh, we can have reform. That in Germany, Die Linke can actually gain power and have reform. I think that day is over. And we have to debate that question, why it's over. One of the reasons it's over is because the system is no longer flexible. The setup is really tighter and tighter and tighter, so that even now we can have a surveillance program by the federal government under a black president. I mean, let's face it.
Right. All right.
And everybody's in surveillance. And there's been no mass protest. We think the Center for Constitutional Rights is going to solve that problem. I love the Center for Constitutional Rights. But that's not where it's going to
end. You got cold pink, though, brother. You got cold pink. Just leaving the other way. You know what I'm saying? You could have got past it. You could have got past it. There's been some motion on that issue. Chris Hedges.
I just wanted to say, as a person that was down at Occupy for a long time, I pretty much from the first few weeks, it was interesting that the criticisms that I saw us garner. And I remember that what he just said about a revolutionary imagination is incredibly important, because we have to have the thinking power to throw the things back that they threw at us. Someone came down there and there was a group of producers, I don't know if they were from Fox, but they were from a series of right-wing institutions, and they said, oh, this is all a bunch of drug addicts. And I approached them and I said, well, wait a minute, what do you mean drug addicts? You mean like people that are sick with an addiction, that are ignored by their government, that are criminalized and then thrown into prison to make money in a prison industrial complex within the system that they don't cure themselves? Is that what you mean about that? They said, oh, this is homeless people. It's just all homeless people. I said, oh, homeless people. That's pretty cool. You mean homeless people like people that lost their homes through a predatory loan because of someone who had decades of experience robbing from people. You know, my father told me something when I was very young. He said, I came out of a police station, I was arrested for something stupid, and I said, I just lied. And he said, don't you ever do that. Don't you ever lie to people that are trained liars. You know, true story. He had a friend of him who came from Russia, Russian immigrant. He played chess, and he came to America. He went to the supermarket with my dad. He goes, oh, I know how you beat us. You know, we just have wheat and sugar and gray and brown boxes. You have wheat and sugar too, but it's sold by a talking frog and an anthropomorphic image of a tiger. It's great for you, but it's not really great. I thought these things were interesting. He said, if I brought you, because I used to play chess as a child, I was a really good kid, really nice chess. I still play now. I'll take it from you. I give it to the course. He asked me, if I brought my professor friend here, he's Russian, but ironically, he plays no chess. He's never played chess in his life. He goes, could you beat him? I said, I'll wipe him off the board right now. I'll give him a rook and a knight, and I'll still take him in 3 moves. My father said, because you know how to play the game. You're dealing with people that know how to play the game. You're coming in there thinking that you can just lie and have some improvisational semantics to get your opponent across. I think these things are incredibly important, because revolutionary imagination is what independent hip-hop, which is what I represent, was built on. The ashes of a crumbled major label industry that failed. It failed just as bad as capitalism. Capitalism didn't just fail here in America, it fails everywhere else around the world. But when a socialist or a left-leaning regime fails, people blame the economic system in the third world. When a capitalist system fails in the third world, they say, well, no, the regime was just corrupt and crooked, as if the ideology that put the regime in power and kept the regime in power and had 50% of Cuba's GDP come in the form of graft payment before the revolution there, as if that wasn't a corrupt institution. So I think that what's important is that that revolutionary ideology be spread amongst all of you, because as a revolutionary, you don't need to just be a rapper or a professor. You could be a revolutionary doctor, a revolutionary lawyer, a revolutionary medical professional, a member of independent media. And what's important to tell young people, because I have young people that roll with me and they don't want to come to forums like this. They say, oh, that's what them old heads talking about. What you gonna do? I've seen younger faces on Cash. I'm not going there. Build a movement. Bring your children here. Bring your grandchildren here. Bring your great-grandchildren here. Bring your cousins. Bring your nephews. Bring your nieces. Remember the story of Sid Harder? His father kept him away from sick people, from poor people, from old people. He didn't want to see it. So when he thought, his mind was blown. But he's the exception to the rule. He's not the rule. Most people, they grow up like him, completely have a skewed view of exactly what poverty is. They think it's the people who are poor's fault that they're poor. It's just their fault. If you just wanted to be rich, you'd be rich. They have these catchphrases, these things that don't mean anything. We're going to reintroduce him to society. How are you going to reintroduce a kid to society that never been a part of society? Right? We want to support the troops. No one wants men and women in uniform to die. But the question is not, do we support the troops? The question is, do we support the policy that someone who never served in the military doesn't understand war, doesn't understand the lives that are at stake? Do we want them to be in charge of the policy? Independent and independent hip-hop reflects all of these thoughts and ideas, because in the mainstream, they would never let you say this. So what happened? We wanted to fund it ourselves. We wanted to do things that hadn't been done with hip-hop. So we took the music that we made, we took a percentage of the proceeds from an album called The Third World, and we built an orphanage in Kabul, in Afghanistan, that's still to this day functional in the organization. And the purpose of doing this was to show all these millionaires and alleged billionaires in hip-hop, if I can do that, an individual who knows nothing about school, I'm honored to be on this panel because I have a high school diploma, and that's just about it. You know what I mean? It's my duty. It's my duty. I'm really not. Me neither. Well, I got girls coming up with that. It's a wild kid. But I just want to say that I really do like the idea that we need to think outside the box, and the idea that even though, you know, France isn't burning and the Bastille hasn't been smashed open, we do have a revolutionary effort. We have the ability to communicate with people and have camaraderie and learn from other people's struggles that we never have. We have the opportunity to look in the past and see the way that the same game has been wrong us. And I just want to close by saying that, to use the chess metaphor, we need to get to a square that's not on the chessboard to win. So everybody, we don't just need your participation, we need your imagination, we need your ideas. The revolution can't be funded just by bake sales and rent parties anymore. We need people with entrepreneurship that isn't self-destructive, that doesn't create a toxic product that kills people.